On the 2nd of August 1935, in a dark and cloudy weather, in the southeast French countryside, 5 minutes after midnight, the P.L.M. International Passenger Train number 658, linking Rome to Paris, pulled by the 141C63, suddenly stops after a violent explosion, which tears grass and weeds off on both sides of the track. The entire boiler flew through the air and landed more than 100 meters away. The rest of the locomotive, the frame and axle staying on the tracks, themselves dislodged and moved aside. The crew, thrown out of the cab, didn't survive the explosion, and the Flamand recorder, used as a black box, was torn to pieces. Today we'll shed some light on what happened that night. The train had recently reached the peak of the line at the La Burbanche station and was coming down a 1.2% downgrade, crossing the Tenay-Hauteville station at what would be determined later the expected speed. As the water level was way too low, actually 25 centimeters below the sheet itself, that for a reason still unknown today, the copper firebox's chrome sheet, now exposed and at least 700 degrees, started to melt and ruptured, causing a rush of steam in the firebox. This was our explosion. Copper plates were deformed and slammed into the opposite side, leaving visible marks and welded staples on the wreck. The sheer force of this opening instantly lifted the firebox into the air, followed by the whole boiler, cutting steam lines and wrecking the cab completely in the process. The boiler flew into the air, bounced back 3 times along the tracks, and finally dug itself in a field 156 meters away from the explosion site. For whatever reason, possibly damage from the explosion to the main pipes, the emergency brakes worked by themselves properly, and the whole train glided to a complete halt without derailing at all. That was witnessed by the PLM agents still alive and on board. Both members of the engine crew were thrown aside the tracks by the explosion. They were terribly mutilated. Following this incident, that thankfully didn't kill anyone else than the working crew themselves, investigations were carried out by the PLM officials on the Wrecksite. They managed to create some maps of the event and reconstruct what happened with the following elements. The exact location of the explosion was found by burnt grass at a certain point along the track, as well as the direction of the hole created by the boiler bounces, which, with the track's curve and related centrifugal forces, safely landed in a field and not on the platform itself, which would have been extremely dangerous for coming trains. It even flew above a telegraphic line without damaging it at all. The bounce's length itself is inconsistent, with the boiler accelerating in the air, reaching 16 meters in height, and flying much further than on a second bounce. The way the crown sheet was ruptured, melted and bent on the wreck meant a single thing. The water level was extremely low, about 380 mm under the reglementary level, and stayed so long enough for the copper to melt completely, that was evidenced by the onboard agent's account of seeing a bright red glow coming from the boiler wreck right after the explosion. That means the three fusible plugs had long bursted and the crew had more than enough time to react, about 9 to 11 minutes, but they didn't. Interestingly enough, the studies have found that there was no attempt to inject water into the boiler made at any time, as that would have cooled the crown sheet down, which, as we've seen, didn't happen. In the same manner, the grate controls were found in the closed position, meaning there was no attempt made to pull the fire out either. Lastly, the clothes the crew were wearing were found damaged but not burned, meaning there was no important leak before the explosion itself. We now enter the realm of speculation, as we don't actually know what exactly happened before the explosion. 141C-623, the locomotive that exploded that night, was built in 1932, so it was actually only 3 years old the day the explosion occurred. Furthermore, she had just gone through a major revision in December 1934, which mentioned she was in good condition. However, in May 1935, her logbook mentioned small issues and damages to both the crown and tubular sheets. In service, reports started to accumulate with demands for reparations to the fed water systems and other pieces around the firebox which apparently didn't work properly. The Sellers injector and Dabeg feed water pump, which was known to have quite a few issues on other locomotives, and the firebox itself were either leaking or not functioning depending on reports. Though these issues probably caused a drop in water level at some point, especially considering the profile of the track made it drop even lower, how did the crew not notice them before the boiler exploded? It's quite common knowledge that railroaders would keep the water level at the bottom of the side glass for the locomotive to steam better, but all three fusible plugs bursted long before the explosion, and that would not have gone unnoticed in a normal situation. According to newspaper entries from the following days and weeks, like Le Journal, a violent storm occurred during that fateful night the train exploded. Having annoyed and scared passengers during the whole night, it could have taken the attention of the crew away from the instruments long enough for the explosion to happen, especially if something was wrong with the locomotive herself, as mentioned earlier. Even worse, some theorized that lightning may have hit the cab and killed both crewmen instantly, leaving the locomotive rolling without control and no one to see the water in the side glass dropping below dangerous levels. This, indeed, would explain why no reaction from the crew to the fusible plug's bursting was recorded, as the later study showed. However, the 80 km/h speed of the train, which was as planned, meant the theory about the crew being already dead before the explosion cannot be true. Furthermore, strangely enough, a station worker from the line testified in a letter that there was no storm in the area that night. It would seem we have another case of conflicting testimonies, or even worse, dramatization by the press. The downhill portion of the track meant they'd probably be going much faster if it were the case. The crew aboard were, technically, not the ordinary crew for the machine. The engineer should have been Mr. Gash, keeping the same fireman as ended up being aboard, which was Joseph Christin. And knowing how essential cohesion and teamwork is for the operation of a steam locomotive, the fact the firing crew was not as planned may explain a general disorganization during the voyage, and that leading to them not noticing precious clues on issues that may have been going on at that moment. The track's profile, a downgrade, coming from a ramp, would mean that if the water level was already barely visible beforehand, as was common practice, as soon as the locomotive plunged stacked first into the descent, the crown sheet may very well have been uncovered and unnoticed for a reason or another. In fact, number 623 was not even supposed to be used for that train and was only taken as a replacement for the engine that was going through maintenance. As a conclusion, the issues noticed in months prior on the locomotive, the profile of the line coupled with the crew's inability to notice the signs of a coming danger, probably due to their lack of experience working together, caused the explosion. In the end, given a few modifications, results could have been much worse, but the creation of a real disaster, killing much more than it actually ended up doing. As a result, this event isn't much known outside of a few railway enthusiasts, apart for its quite impressive appearance, but it's probably for the better, considering famous railway disasters are often known for their high death toll.